So, Peter, in theory, today should all be review, but I also know in Physics 11, when I get to the unit on forces, that's where students have told me consistently, wow, that was a more difficult unit because I couldn't just say, find an equation. You have to derive everything yourself. So, Graydon, what I've found is reviewing it this year, the students almost always say, okay, things became much clearer. What is a force? A force is a push or a pull. That's a bad definition in terms of physics. A force is an interaction between two objects when they exchange leptons. We'll just say, Owen, a force is a push or a pull. Key ideas, a force is a vector. It has a magnitude measured in newtons. Forces are based on interactions between two objects. You have to have two objects for forces to occur. Why? You might remember, because forces come in pairs. If you had an object sitting in deep outer space where there was no gravity and there were no objects around it, no forces could act on it. No forces could occur. Just as a thought experiment. Some important forces that we're going to study in the course will include the following. We'll see if we remember these from last year. Who remembers? What was the name that we gave to the force that was the Earth pulling on all objects downwards towards the planet's center? Okay, so we called this one gravity. And we abbreviated that one, Owen, as capital F with a subscripted G, force of gravity. We're going to look at that one in more detail later on in this course. We're going to ask, can you calculate gravity even if you don't know the acceleration on the planet? And the answer is yes, you can. What was the force that could be described as microscopic hills and valleys between an object and a surface that interlock and prevent or impede sliding? What was that one? Yeah, that one was friction. Mu is not friction. Mu is used to calculate friction. And I wrote this as FFR. And in fact, I think I said to you, for some reason, I put the R there. Every other textbook will just say FF. I don't know why I put the R there. It's a habit. It's the only time you'll ever see me write an extra unnecessary letter, because I'm sure I've used the phrase lazy but organized with you before. It's just a habit. What was the name of the force that was actually the surface pushing up on an object, preventing the objects from sinking into the surface? It was also the apparent weight of an object. What did we call? What was that one called? We called it the normal force. And I used Fn. Some textbooks will use capital N, but we already have capital N for Newton's, capital N for North. So I use F with a subscripted capital N for normal force. What name did we give to the force from a stretched spring? It was constant throughout the entire string or rope or cable. I used a capital T. Sometimes we'll use an F subscripted T because I shouldn't use a capital T. Capital T is taken by something else. And we will run into a situation later this year where we have two T's, two capital T's in the same equation. And so we'll use FT for tension because the something else is more important. What was the name that we gave to a contact force from an external agent, usually coming from off the page? I said, I don't know what this force is. Something is something. We called it the applied force. That was me saying, I'm not going to make up a story. Something's applying a force. Could be a person, could be invisible unicorns, leprechauns. I don't care. Something's applying a force. And I called that F app. What was the name that we gave to the force of resistance from the air? It was always opposite to the direction of motion. Air resistance is the casual name. The fancy name is drag. So I'm going to write down the word drag, but it's also air resistance. And in fact, I usually wrote it as F air. We said several times last year, Owen, calculating air resistance is actually really, really difficult. We'll look at it occasionally in snapshots, but most of the time we'll ignore air resistance unless the question specifically says include air resistance. The last one was not a specific force. It was the vector sum or the resultant of all of the forces acting on the object. It was the something force, started with letter N. The what force? The what force? The what force? You might recall that little chant that I did a few times. I think you're right, Sebastian. Nope, normal's already taken. Three letters, starts with an N. Then an E. Sorry? The net force. So the net force is the vector sum of all the forces. It never showed up on the free body diagram. It was what you got when you added everything up. But if they told you the net force, you could go straight to F equals what MA. That's a lie, by the way. So this is not on your test, but I have been lying to you. There are only four fundamental forces in the universe. Most of the forces that I've just listed are combinations or manifestations of the four fundamental forces. What are the four fundamental forces? Well, gravity is an actual force. Maybe. Einstein suggested that gravity is not a force, but it's a curvature of space-time. And so, if you're someone who is a general relativist, you would say there's only three fundamental forces. Gravity is curvature, not a force. And we won't get into that debate, but it's legit. There's something called the strong nuclear force, sometimes just called the strong force. This is the force that holds the nucleus of an atom together. It acts over very, very short distances only. How short? Like the inside of an atomic nucleus diameter, which is crazy small. If it didn't exist, protons would repel each other because like charges repel, and protons are like charges. No atoms would be stable. So it overcomes that repulsion force. That's the strong nuclear force. Well, if there's a strong nuclear force, Orazio, there's also something called the weak nuclear force. This also acts over very small distances, like the diameter of an atomic nucleus. This helps explain things like radioactive decay. It's complicated, but it explains radioactive decay. So, oh yeah, both nuclear forces act over very short distances, about the diameter of an atomic nucleus. The last one is electromagnetism. This is the force that basically explains almost everything else. Tension is a consequence of electromagnetism. The normal force is a consequence of electromagnetism. What other ones did I say up here? Drag is technically a consequence of electromagnetism. All the other ones are combinations of that. But we're not going to dive into those four. Oh, I wrote here, for example, let's look at what we call the normal force. It's actually force. Number four, it's actually electromagnetism. We don't dive into that level, Orazio, every time, because when it comes right down to it, everything is explained through quantum physics. We don't go down that far. We're going to stay zoomed out. And so we will pretend that the normal force is a force, that friction is a force, that tension is a force, even though technically they're not. I went on a big rant last year about Newton's laws. So Isaac Newton said, I can explain how everything in the universe moves with three rules, three laws. The first law often says objects at rest tend to remain at rest, objects in motion tend to remain in motion, huh? Or every object in a state of uniform motion tends to remain in that state of motion unless an external force is applied to it, huh? Oh, and basically it says the only way that you can accelerate an object or change its velocity is to apply an unbalanced outside force. If forces are balanced, A must be zero. If A isn't zero, forces can't be balanced. This law is also often called the law of intertia, the law of inertia. Get rid of the T, Mr. Dewick. It's often called the law of inertia because the more inertia an object has, the more it resists a change to its motion state. I gave you some examples last year. For example, we looked at right now, there's enough ice that there's no friction. This is how objects behave in outer space. They move in a straight line at a steady speed until the force acts on them. There, the force acts on them and changes velocity. But right now, it's going to keep going in a straight line at a steady speed until another force acts on it. Wait for it. There, it changes the speed. Interesting. This car wants to keep going in a straight line at a steady speed. A force is going to get applied only to this tire, and you're going to see the rest of the car is going to pivot around the left front driver's side tire and want to keep going in a straight line at a steady speed. So they want it to keep going in a straight line at a steady speed. They should have cut their losses. This driver stopped. They should have just said, they didn't. So now they're just going to accelerated. Yeah, this was actually tied into the hill, just enough not only to overcome friction, but to cause it to speed up a little bit. Luckily, they hit a spot here. Stop. I would not be playing on roads like this, because you can't move, or it can't stop. So this car here, should have cut its losses. Should have stayed.
Heads up!
There it is. No forces acting on it. It was in a straight line at a steady speed. They're trying to break. Nothing's going to happen until there's an interaction with outside forces applied to it. There's the outside force. It's lost. So there's one. Here's another one. These leaves have inertia. So this person is going to apply a force to the net. Watch the leaves. No force was applied to the leaves, so they remain at rest, at least for a while. And then the net applies a force upwards on the leaves, and so they bounce upwards. That's a pretty nice example of Newton's first law. The leaves stayed where they are. I think I showed you last year the subway sleeper. Yes. So we had, this is from physics 11. Person falling asleep on the subway. You've all experienced something like that, not as quite as dramatic, if you've fallen asleep in a car and the car changes direction. You often wake up then, and it's for the same reason. What else did I have? Space station reboost.
Here we are at the International Space Station. We're doing a reboost right now, and we're showing that the space station is actually accelerating away from us.
So the rockets are thrusting the space station forward. They're doing a reboost. What that means is if the astronauts lift their feet up, they're going to remain at rest. It's going to look a ratio like they're accelerating backwards. No, we and the camera are accelerating forwards.
Because we're going to float in the middle of the cabin.
They're remaining
and it started
where
already.
They are. We're accelerating.
We start off, stopped, in front of the camera.
And you can see.
And we get moved. The space station's accelerating, leaving us behind.
Yeah, that's yeah. Wow. 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 Ooh.
they all have engineering and PhDs and degrees, but it's sometimes amazing. You're an eight-year-old kid again, too, right? In fact, this astronaut's one of my favorites. You'll see him later on this year. He did something on the International Space Station when he was there that had you thought of it, you absolutely would have done the same thing. That's called a teaser. We'll get to that later on.
Floating still.
Oh, wow. Wow.
And he is speeding up as well. There is an acceleration. So those are some video examples of Newton's first. Of course, I also have a pretty good actual example, but I got to pause the video. So that's the magician and tablecloth demo. Newton's second law is the equation. It's the main equation we'll be using during this unit. It's the mathematical relationship between mass and force and acceleration. It says force equals mass times acceleration. F equals what? Ma. Most of you will memorize it. It's on your formula sheet, but out of laziness, this one is worth memorizing, Owen, because you're going to get sick of looking it up. So F equals what? F equals Ma. Newton's third law is often called the law of action-reaction. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction, which is confusing. Mr. Duex says this. Forces come in technically opposite pairs, but we'll probably shorten that to forces come in pairs. As an equation, it says this. The force of object A on object B equals negative force of object B on object A. Forces come in pairs. The force of A on B equals negative the force of B on A. So, why would an athlete want low mass shoes? Based on what you learned last year about forces, why would an athlete want low mass shoes? Tori? F equals what? Get the A by itself. So we have A equals F over M. Owen, let's suppose that you've lifted weights, you've trained, you've made your legs as strong as possible, so you can't increase the force. But if I can make the shoes lighter as M gets smaller, what's going to happen to my acceleration? Yeah. As M decreases, A increases. My abbreviation for decreases is an arrow pointing down. My abbreviation for increases is an arrow pointing up. Okay, suppose you were on the International Space Station and one of your astronaut partners threw something at you and you decided to let it hit you in the face in zero G. Would it hurt? Philip says yes, Graydon says no. Convince, one of you is right. Convince me. Would it hurt to get hit in the face by a moving object while in zero G? Who remembers from last year, I repeated this a few times, what does damage in a collision? Acceleration. So the real question is, would there be an acceleration in zero G? Would there be, yes? Okay, so let's suppose the object hits you. Will its velocity change when it hits you? Yes. Does it have mass even in zero G? So if we have a mass and we have an acceleration, what else do we have? Ma. Yeah, it'll apply force, and forces come in pairs. You'll feel it. Yes. There is M and A in zero G. Therefore, three dots mean therefore, there will be force. Oh, yeah. A force with which you have had some experience is the force of gravity between you and the Earth. This force is also known as weight. The force of gravity, a synonym for that is weight. Now, and it's measured in newtons or pounds in the old system. Pounds are not a measure of mass. Does anybody know in the imperial system, what are the units for mass? In the SI system, it's kilograms. What are the units for mass in the old imperial system? It's stupid. This is where I always sigh and say, no one bothered reading ahead in the paragraph. Mass is the amount of matter in an object, measured in kilograms or slugs in the old system. To relate mass to force, we need to know the number of newtons of force per kilogram of matter. And this is known as, here's your new term that I'm going to use often this year, gravitational field strength. Near the Earth's surface, the gravitational field strength is 9.8 newtons per kilogram. Mr. Duick, that 9.8 looks familiar. What else have we called that 9.8? Okay, it's the acceleration due to gravity. Well, first of all, Philip, what are the units for gravitational field strength? What per what? That's force over mass. Doesn't that by definition have to be acceleration? Because F equals one. The reason objects accelerate at 9.8 meters per second is because Earth's gravity tugs on them with 9.8 newtons of force on every kilogram. That must result in an acceleration of 9.8 meters per second squared. So we have this. The force of gravity is mg. And the gravitational field strength is the force of gravity divided by the mass, and this is in newtons per kilogram. Well, of course, that would also be an acceleration. Moon's gravity field is about 1.6 newtons per kilogram. Earth's gravity field is 9.8 newtons per kilogram. In other words, objects on Earth in a vacuum accelerate at 9.8 meters per second squared downwards. Objects on the moon, which has a vacuum, accelerate at 1.6 meters per second squared downwards. Yes? Okay. Example 2 says, find the weight of a 10 kilogram object on the Earth and on the moon. Isn't the weight 10 kilograms? Sorry? That's mass. Weight and mass are not the same thing. So if I want to find the weight, remember, weight is Fg. I'm going to go, that's an arrow pointing to there. I'm going to go Fg equals mg, but I'll use the Earth's gravitational field. It's going to be 10 times 9.8, which is, I'm pretty sure, 98 newtons. On the moon, it's going to be mg, but Owen, I'll use the moon's gravitational field, which is 10 times. Is it 1.6? Is that what I said in the last sentence there? That's why the astronauts were able to move around in their spacesuits. On the Earth, their spacesuits weighed on the order of about 300 pounds. I know that number from the old imperial system. On the moon, they weighed on the order of about 50 pounds. That's just like having a fairly heavy backpack, but you can move around with that. The mass didn't change. The weight did. Ooh, we have a thought puzzle. Read along with me. It says this. Select the best answer. If a force of gravity acts on an object, then the object A remains at rest, B moves at a constant speed, C accelerates in the direction of the force, or D, all of the above. If the force of gravity acts on an object, then the object A remains at rest, B moves at a constant speed, C accelerates in the direction of the force, or D may remain at rest, move at a constant velocity, or accelerate. Once again, we're going to vote. Once again, I hold your hand up as I'm sure you are. Of the answer. Who says, Mr. Duick, I think when gravity acts on an object, it remains at rest? No one. No, it moves at a constant speed, terminal velocity. No. Now, accelerates in the direction of the force. Really? I got one. All of the above. Why is this the correct answer? Can you give me a situation where A could be true? How can an object remain at rest but also have gravity acting on it? Tori. Sure. Book sitting on table. How can an object be moving at a constant speed and have gravity acting on it? Yeah. More specific. Because initially when I jumped out of an airplane, when I jumped out of an airplane, I was not moving at a constant speed. When was I moving at a constant speed? We have a fancy schmancy name for it. Okay, terminal velocity. When air resistance and gravity equal each other, the forces are balanced. If the forces are, I'm looking for it starts to let it be balanced, what's my acceleration exactly as a number? Zero. C would be free fall in a vacuum. Sure. Or right at the beginning before air resistance kicks in. So B must be the correct answer. Is that okay? Oratio C? Yeah. No, D. Not C. D. D. C? D. C? So, Newton's first law says if we have balanced forces, then objects at rest remain at rest and objects in motion remain in motion. If we have balanced forces, If we have balanced forces, A equals zero. That's really what it says. You can't be accelerating. If we have unbalanced forces, A can't be zero. And you know what? You'll be accelerating in the direction of the unbalanced or net force. F net, or the sum of all the forces, equals the net force. F net is not a real force. It's not based on an interaction. It's the vector sum of all of the forces in newtons from your free body diagram. So what I told you last year, we said F net equals MA. And Philip, you and I just made the argument that newtons per kilogram and meters per second squared are the same, because newtons per kilogram, that's force over mass. Well, that must be an acceleration. So another term for acceleration due to gravity, the term I used last year for that 9.8 was the acceleration due to gravity. More and more this year, I'm going to use the phrase gravitational field strength, which is measured in newtons per kilogram. Black holes have a big gravitational field strength when you get close to them. In theory, in the middle of outer space where there's nothing around you, the gravitational field strength would be zero. And you can still think of that also as the acceleration due to gravity, but we can take it further now. One of the things we talked an awful lot about last year was finding the unbalanced or the net force, magnitude and direction. It says, find the unbalanced or net force in each case. Let's make this let's put a compass rose here. Let's say we're looking down so we can go northeast, southwest. Number one, Braden, will start out simple. What is the net force, magnitude and direction for part A? Direction? Yes. F net equals 2 newtons at east. Okay. Little trick here, Suhani. What's the net force in part B, magnitude and direction? Are they in the same direction? So what can we do with them vectorially? Just add them up. So use your calculator if you need to, but get me an answer. Yep. 3.7 newtons south. Again, that's my hideous at symbol. Make that a little better. Ooh. Owen, what do you think the net force is in part C? Three up, two down, or three north, two south. What's that the same as, do you think? Yes. 1 newton at north. This is why I don't use N for normal force as well, because that would be three capital N's in one question. That's a little confusing. Okay. Manat, what do you think that the net force is in D? How did you get that? You let one way be positive and one way be negative. Really, you went, or what I taught my students last year, I said winner minus loser. What I was really introducing was some vector mathematics. Yeah, the net force here is going to be 5 newtons east. Jericho's yawning. Jericho, part E, in the north-south direction, what's the net force as a number exactly? Zero. Now, here's what that means. It means in the north-south direction, we're either at rest in that component or we're moving at a constant velocity in that component. I don't know which one of those is correct. All I can say is I know I'm not accelerating north-south. What is the net force overall? Okay. Philip, algebraically, what's the net force in part F? Sorry? No. Algebraically, how would I calculate the net force in F? It would just be Y minus X, would it not? Because they're in opposite directions. Not Y south, Y minus X newtons. And they said Y is bigger, so I can say south, but I would go winner minus loser. There's my generic one, yes? More and more this year on tests and quizzes, I'm going to give you questions like this with no numbers and say, okay, algebraically, how would you do it? Because if you can do it once algebraically, I don't need to make up a bunch of examples. There, you've got it down pat. So you snuck one, and now you're going to see them showing up more and more in the homework, okay? How do we solve force problems? We draw a free body diagram, or an FBD. You draw one arrow for each force that acts on an object. You draw the arrows roughly to scale. In other words, if you know one force is bigger, Owen, make that arrow bigger. If you know one force is smaller, make that arrow smaller. F net never shows up on the free body diagram because it's the vector sum of all the forces on your free body diagram. Put the tail of the arrow at the center of the object if you can. Sometimes if it's cluttered, you might need to move the tail a little bit over. My friend who typed this, he actually has his kids show acceleration and velocity on free body diagrams. He uses squiggly arrows for acceleration and dotted lines for velocity. I don't. I haven't removed that from this, but I generally like my free body diagrams to be pristine, forces only. And then we'll use the free body diagram to write an algebraic net force equation like Philip tried to do in example 4F. We'll solve for any unknowns. Our net force equation will be derived by using a tug of war analogy. Again, this year, we'll ask ourselves, which force is winning? Which force is bigger? Which way are we accelerating? That's all the same question. And we're going to use winner minus loser equals F net, although instead of F net, we're just going to say MA. We're going to use winner minus loser equals MA. This will allow us to avoid having to choose which way is positive, which way is negative. If it makes the math easier, we'll let down be positive. Example 5. A 2,000 Newton rock hanging from a rope accelerates upwards at 3 meters per second squared. A says, draw a free body diagram. In fact, the phrase I used with you last year often, I would have said, this is a job for a, and all of you would have said, free body diagram. So let's do the free body diagram right over here in the margin. There's the rock. What are the forces acting on it? And then last year, I always said, get the obvious one. Which one did I mean by the obvious one? Yeah, so go systematically. Don't try and rush to the tough force that you're trying to find. If you go systematically, often you'll clue in where you're headed before you get there. So gravity down. There is FG. Corey, which way are we accelerating? Which way must there be a bigger unbalanced force pointing? Same answer, upwards. I know there has to be a bigger arrow pointing up. That's what Newton's first says. Oh, and I exaggerate it, so it's stupid obvious. What force is pulling up on this? I'll give you a hint, you're feeling it right now. Yeah, tension, the rope. So A said, draw a free body diagram. I did that. B says, compare the forces. I did that on my free body diagram because which is the bigger force? Okay. C says, write a net equation. So for part C, a net force equation, I'm going to say, who's winning? Jericho, who is winning? Minus, who's the loser? Peter, did you see? I said, who's the loser? And he looked at you. Wow. Fine, Jericho. Who's the losing force? What does winner minus loser always equal? MA. Yeah, the net force, but we'll go straight to MA. Fine, Jericho, you're so smart. What's this question asking us to find? Part D. How would you get the T by itself? So T is going to be MA plus MG. This is kind of weird. They gave me MG as a number. Jericho, what's MG as a number exactly? Look at your question, not up. Oh, no, it is on the screen still here. Sorry. Pardon me? 3 is a bad guess because what are the units next to the 3? Don't be telling me an acceleration is a force. What's? Yeah, they gave me. Why? Because what are the units next to that 2,000? Kilograms? They gave me the weight. MG is 2,000. What's that 3? Why? Because what are the units next to it, bro? Okay. Ooh. Do I know the mass? It's not 2,000 because there would have been a kilograms next to that. How can I figure out the mass if I know the weight? So it's going to be 2,000 divided by 9.8. What do you get? Go to your calculator and type this in. I got 2,600. I'll go to 3 sig figs, 2610 newtons. If they wanted a direction, which direction? Look at your free body diagram. Up. Okay. Ooh, this is interesting. We're going to vote. We got a true false question. Is it correct to say that if the rock in example 5 is moving upwards, then the string tension must always be greater than the weight of the rock? The weight of the rock was 2,000. We got a tension of 2,610. If the rock is moving upwards, will the string tension always be greater than the weight of the rock? It's a good question. We're going to vote. Who says, Mr. Duick? Yeah, I think that's true. If the rock is moving upwards, tension has to be bigger than the weight. Got one? I got two, I got three, I got four. Who says, I think that's false? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Convince me. Caden. But then the cable wouldn't be part of it. I don't think I'm going to take the cable snapping explanation. Philip, which one are you defending? True or false? Okay. If A equals zero, can you still be moving up? Yes. Because it just means you're not accelerating. It doesn't mean you're at rest. If you were moving up, but A was zero, forces would be, I'm looking forward, that starts letter B. So if A equals zero, then MG would equal tension. I've just given you an example where the tension isn't bigger. It's equal to the weight of the rock, but it's still moving up. Okay, so that would be at a constant velocity at an acceleration of zero. Tension and weight are equal, so tension is not bigger than mg. You okay with that? Is that what you were thinking when you voted that way? Nice. Are you lying? Mixed. Okay. Well, here we've got another follow-up. Example seven. Okay, Duick. For a rock moving upwards, is it ever possible for the core tension to be less than the weight of the rock? I've shown you can be equal. Can it be less than? Who says, yes, it can be less than? Of course it can be. I got one. I got two. No, it can't be less than. It's got to be bigger or equal to. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12. Convince me. Convince me. Peter, what were you thinking? If it's moving up, but it's slowing down, which way is it? We don't like to use the term decelerating, but it's accelerating in which direction? Which would be the winning direction? Down. Which would be the bigger force? Down. Yeah. If we're moving up, but slowing down, then A is downwards. And what that means is MG is bigger than tension because MG is winning. So all three of those are possible. The most common, sure, tension's bigger than MG, but constant velocity or slowing down. All three of those occur in an elevator, by the way, because the elevator initially starts accelerating up. Tension's bigger, hits a constant speed pretty quick, forces are balanced, slows down when you approach the next floor, mg's bigger. Technical comment on equations and vectors. If the mass of example 5 is accelerating down, we have two choices. We can let down be negative and up be positive. Right is positive, left is negative. But that becomes cumbersome. It works okay for single masses. But in a situation like this, where you have one object accelerating to the right, positive, and one object accelerating down, negative, it's going to get confusing. So what we're going to do is we're going to let whatever way we're accelerating be the positive direction. Okay? What's your homework? And then we'll do the tricycle. Number one is good. Two is good. Three is good. Three, here's an example of a purely algebraic question with no numbers. If you don't like it, make up some numbers and see what happens. Four is good. Five is good. Six is good. Seven is good. Eight is good. I'll skip nine. Skip 10. 11 is good. 12, 13, 14 is good. 15, these are all conceptual. This is not due Thursday. This is due a week from today, which is why I'm giving you a fair bit. So you can cross out 9 and 10. And I think that's the only ones you can cross out. I'm going to pause the video, and we're going to do a thought puzzle.